Starting off from their humble origins on the frontier of northwestern Anatolia, by 1389, the Ottomans had aggressively expanded their realm across Anatolia and the Balkans. They were now poised to extend their conquests in all directions. Even the fabled city of Constantinople was caught in the crosshairs of Ottoman ambition. But emerging from the steppes of Central Asia, the legendary Turco-Mongolian conqueror, Timur, would momentarily put an end to all of that. What followed next was a critical chapter in the empire's history, which saw it confronted by the prospect of its own mortality and the need to bounce back from near destruction. Sultan Murad's assassination at the Battle of Kosovo in 1389 meant that a new sultan had to take his place. His son Bayezid immediately took the reins of control, executing his brother Yaqub on the battlefield. Deservedly nicknamed Yildirim, meaning Thunderbolt, Bayezid's reign was an active one, filled with military campaigns and conquest. His father's death was interpreted as an opportunity by some of the Anatolian beyliks to move against the increasingly powerful and aggressive Ottomans. So Bayezid spent the first 3 years of his reign campaigning against his fellow Turkic beyliks. With the help of soldiers provided by his Christian vassals, he was able to take over all of western Anatolia. This expansion benefited the Ottomans economically, as they now had greater control of the land and sea trade routes that connected east and west. After making peace with the powerful Karamanid Beylik, Bayezid set his focus on Europe. At the same time, in 1394, Constantinople was put under siege by the Ottomans for the first time. Being caught in the middle of their territories, Constantinople would have been the logical choice for an Ottoman capital. In the Balkans, Bayezid quickly annexed Bulgaria and Macedonia, and he even threatened to move beyond the Danube River. This alarmed the Hungarians, who at the time were a great power in their own right. At the behest of various parties, a crusade was organized in 1396 to stem the advance of the Ottomans. The Crusader forces, led by King Sigismund of Hungary, were decisively defeated at the Battle of Nicopolis. Victory meant that Ottoman control of the Balkans south of the Danube River was undisputed. Commemorating the victory, Bayezid commissioned the Great Mosque of Bursa, the first in a long list of magnificent mosques that would come to form an enduring aspect of the Ottomans' legacy. Once the Balkans were neutralized, Bayezid resumed his campaign against the Beyliks of eastern Anatolia. In around 1398, he turned his attention to the two most powerful ones, the Karamanids and Eretna of Kadi Burhanuddin. Bayezid soon annexed both to the Ottoman realm. It has to be noted that all this tremendous growth was thanks in part to the Devşirme, the system of youth levy imposed on its Christian subjects, mainly in the Balkans. As part of this, young boys would forcibly be taken away and recruited into the Ottoman administration and military. The famed Janissary Infantry Unit were formed out of this system. Whilst there is evidence to suggest that the Ottoman practice of youth levies had existed earlier, it was really in the reign of Bayezid that it was institutionalized. Sultan Bayezid's expansion into eastern Anatolia opened up the prospect of a conflict with the great Turco-Mongolian conqueror, Timur, who at the turn of the 15th century was on campaign in Syria against the Mamluks, Timur viewed himself as the successor to the Mongol Ilkhanate dynasty's claim over Anatolia. The imperial ambitions of both men made an eventual conflict somewhat inevitable. Tensions culminated at the epic Battle of Ankara in 1402, where Timur's forces prevailed over the Ottomans and even managed to capture Sultan Bayezid. The beleaguered Sultan would die in captivity a few months later. Most of the beyliks annexed by Bayezid now became independent again, and the impending Ottoman takeover of Constantinople was delayed by 50 years. But the true significance of the Battle of Ankara was that it immediately brought about one of the most destructive episodes in Ottoman history, the Ottoman Interregnum. A civil war that lasted 11 years, it saw four of Bayezid's sons contest the throne: Isa, Suleiman, Mehmet, and Musa. All fought until only one was left. The war experienced various twists and turns. Isa was knocked out at the start of the conflict. Subsequently, the eldest brother, Suleiman, was in the ascendancy until 1410, but he passed on his authority to Musa, who defeated and executed him. Musa was then defeated by Mehmet in 1413, and the new Sultan began to piece the empire back together. In Anatolia, Mehmet was unable to exert an aggressive policy towards the beyliks, fearing disapproval from Timur's son and successor, Shahrukh. In Europe, the Christian Balkan states acted independently and had even regained some land back. But fortunately for the Ottomans, their Balkan rivals could not effectively take advantage of their weakness, meaning that their position in Rumelia remained fairly strong. So why were the Ottomans able to survive a politically traumatic experience like an 11-year-long civil war? The most convincing answer has been offered by the esteemed Turkish historian Halil İnalcık, who argued that it was because of the system of central government, which provided the Ottoman state with a strong infrastructure that could thus withstand the shock of the civil war. The slaves turned administrators that were developed from the Devşirme system offered the dynasty a level of continuity and stability even as the civil war raged on. Sultan Mehmet's death in 1421 brought about a succession that showed that the ghosts of the Ottoman civil war were still alive. Mehmet was succeeded by his young son, Murad II, who immediately had to contend with his uncle Mustafa for the throne. Mustafa had been held by the Byzantine Emperor, Manuel II, who enjoyed a slight resurgence of his authority in the aftermath of the Battle of Ankara, partly due to the Byzantine policy of keeping Ottoman claimants to the throne and then releasing them at opportune times so that the ensuing divisions could wreak havoc on their Turkish foes. Murad's uncle, although considered by the Ottomans to be an imposter, was able to take control of Rumelia and looked poised to knock his nephew off the throne. Mustafa had the support of various prominent Muslim frontier warrior leaders in the Balkans, who had been essential in the expansion of the Ottoman realm into Christian territories. But at times, they grew disillusioned by the Ottoman efforts to centralize its authority over territories that the frontier warriors had conquered with the Ottomans. In 1422, Murad II was able to defeat his uncle and executed him. But his internecine woes were not over. In the same year, he decided to punish the Byzantines for their meddling in Ottoman affairs by putting Constantinople under siege. The Anatolian beyliks, fond of their newfound independence, saw this as an opportunity to deal a blow to the Ottomans. Murad's younger brother, who was also called Mustafa and had fled to the Karamanids upon his father's death, was encouraged by various beyliks to stake his claim for the throne. Equipped with an army, he besieged Bursa, thus forcing Murad to call off his siege of Constantinople and deal with his little brother. Shortly thereafter, Murad defeated and strangled his younger brother to death. In the mid-1420s, Murad put an end to all the beyliks of Western Anatolia by annexing them for the last time. Having thus consolidated his rule, Sultan Murad II now shifted his focus to the Balkans. After reconquering the city of Thessaloniki in 1430 from the Venetians, much of Murad's focus in the region revolved around the rivalry with Hungary. Serbia, a long-time vassal, was annexed into the Ottoman realm in 1439. In the background to this, renewed efforts had been made by various parties in Christendom for a crusade against the Ottomans. In 1439, the centuries-long schism between Catholicism and Orthodox Christianity was officially ended. This Christian optimism led to the Crusade of Varna in 1443. Originally starting well for the Crusaders, the multinational coalition soon slowed down when a visible disconnect began to emerge between the Balkan states and the Western Christian Crusaders. This resulted in the Balkan Christians agreeing to a truce with the Sultan in the summer of 1444. Sultan Murad immediately followed this up by crossing into Anatolia and making peace with the Karamanids. With both his eastern and western frontiers secured, Sultan Murad remarkably decided to abdicate in favor of his 12-year-old son, Mehmet II. Sensing an opportunity, the Hungarians immediately reneged on the truce. The Ottoman Grand Vizier, Chandarli Halil Pasha, recalled the retired Sultan, who duly responded by marching straight to the battlefield at Varna on the Rumelian coast of the Black Sea. At the subsequent Battle of Varna, the Ottomans defeated the Christian coalition and Murad went back into his retirement. His second retirement was only a little longer than his first one. The young Sultan Mehmet's decision to debase the currency drew widespread negative reactions, especially from those employed by the state, such as the Janissaries. So in 1446, once again at the request of the Grand Vizier, Sultan Murad came back to take his crown. Despite the victory at Varna, Ottoman authority in the Balkans was still unstable. In Albania, Gjergj Kastrioti, also known as Skanderbeg, was in the beginning stages of his 25-year-long resistance against the Ottomans. Further north, the danger from the Hungarians had not been extinguished. Under the leadership of the energetic regent John Hunyadi, Hungary organized a Christian coalition which had a showdown with Sultan Murad's forces at the fiercely contested Second Battle of Kosovo in 1448. Similar to the First Battle of Kosovo in 1389, the result was an Ottoman victory, and just like the first one, the implications were significant. The Balkans were pacified for the time being, and the fate of the iconic city, Constantinople, was sealed. Nobody was going to come to their rescue now. War-weary from constant conflict, Murad finally got the peace he wanted when he passed away in 1451. His son Mehmet was now a young man and demonstrated great energy right from the beginning. Even in his first reign in the 1440s, Mehmet had surrounded himself with hawkish advisors for whom the conquest of Constantinople was high up on their list of priorities. Having planned it for almost 2 years, Mehmet finally besieged the city in April 1453. For 7 weeks, Ottoman cannons blasted the walls of a blockaded Constantinople. Finally, on Tuesday the 29th of May 1453, Janissary troops entered through a breach in the walls opened by cannon fire. The Second Rome had fallen to the Muslims. Mehmet II became Mehmet Fatih, the conqueror. And the Ottomans were now ready to fulfill Usman's dream. As usual, I want to thank my patrons for being awesome and generous. If you want to support the channel, there's a link to my Patreon in the description to this video. Join me next time as I continue the story of the Ottomans. Until then, peace!